My favorite player of all time was a guy by the name of Richie Allen.
Fresh, buddy. Yoo-hoo!
Yeah, man.
Go Phillies.
You go Phillies. Take the Eagles with you.
There's a White Sox
club. You might have won the MVP there.
But before he played for the White Sox, and before he played for the Dodgers, and before he played for the Cardinals, he was with the Philadelphia Phillies. And in 1964, he was the Rookie of the Year for the National League.
201 hits.
He was a perennial All-Star. In fact, the Phillies were so bad those years, most of the time he was the only All-Star. But he was a big power hitter, had lots of home runs, and fans used to boo him every time he came up to bat, and I didn't understand this as a kid. My dad always taught me to root for the home team. I've never once booed the Phillies in my entire lifetime. God knows, though, that they deserved it. They didn't do so until 1957, which was 10 years after Jackie Robinson. But before that was 1957, Richie Allen got called up to the Phillies in 1964, so it was only 7 years after they'd integrated. And he was really the first African American they ever had of any kind of star caliber. And back then, African American ball players were expected to just keep their mouths shut, keep their heads down, and play ball. Richie Allen was outspoken. That just wasn't him, you know. Well, the year before the Phillies called him up, he played in Little Rock, Arkansas for their farm club there, where he became the very first African-American to cross Arkansas's color line. This was 16 years after Jackie Robinson. And we all know about those infamous luncheonette encounters in Little Rock. I actually know a cool story about a luncheonette situation. There was a dark-skinned ball player from Puerto Rico by the name of Vic Power. One time he walked into a luncheonette in Little Rock and they told him, "We don't serve colored people." And he said, "Well, I don't eat colored people. I want some rice and beans." I can imagine what Richie Allen had to go through in 1963. So in 1964, when the Phillies called him up to the major leagues, he thought that kind of stuff was behind him. But we all know, unfortunately, there are racists all across this planet, and Philadelphia's no exception. But they would boo him every time he came up to bat. It wasn't until I had a chance to read through his file at the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York, as an adult, that I learned about the racism of the day, and in particular, the incident between a very popular Phillies player named Frank Thomas and Richie Allen. One day before batting practice in 1965, Frank Thomas was teasing Richie Allen, and he let a racial slur slip out of his mouth, and Richie Allen took offense, and they had a bit of a fist fight. Frank Thomas grabbed a baseball bat and he hit Richie Allen with it. Not hard enough to hurt him, but this happened in front of the fans, so it couldn't be swept under the rug. And the next day, Frank Thomas was released from the team. But he just happened to host a talk radio program during the morning drive time. So the following day, he got a chance to tell a great big lie to thousands and thousands of listeners, claiming Richie Allen had started this fight. So from that point on, things just got really vicious and out of hand. Well, Richie Allen never made any kind of obscene gesture back at fans when the booing would happen. He'd just take it and wait patiently until the Phillies were back out in the field on defense. His original position in the major leagues was third base, but after a couple of seasons, they switched him to left field, and then they ultimately put him at first base. And so he would stand there at first base, and in between pitches, he'd write words in the dirt around the base with his shoes, great big letters, 6-foot-tall letters. He'd spell out "boo" right back at the fans. Of course, they only booed more when he did that. One day, Commissioner of Baseball was visiting Philadelphia, taking in the game there, and he saw Richie Allen do this, and as you might imagine, didn't think this was proper behavior for Major League ball players. So he sent word down to the Phillies dugout to the manager, Gene Mauch, tell Richie Allen to quit writing words in the dirt. Richie Allen ran out the next inning and wrote "no." when the sports writer asked him about that, he said, well, only my mother can tell me what to do. I wrote the song for my dad. So he was out there representing them on some kind of baseball business, and I was told by the director of research at the Hall of Fame, Mr. Tim Wiles, that most likely he'd be staying at the Odasaga Hotel, a grand old five-star hotel in Cooperstown. It's where all baseball VIPs would stay. He suggested I take a drive over there and maybe see if I could leave a copy of the CD with a song on it at the front desk, and maybe I'd get lucky and they'd pass it on to him. So I thought, why not? I got to lose. So I drove over there. I walked in the lobby door, and to my absolute amazement, there himself was Dick Allen, standing in the lobby having a conversation with somebody else. So I just waited off to the side, and when they finished talking, I walked over and introduced myself. Told him I'd grown up watching him play in Philadelphia, and that even to this day, he's still my favorite baseball player of all time. Well, that I'd written a song for him and pulled the CD out of my coat pocket and handed it to him. He was a little taken aback, I think. He held it in both of his hands and looked down at it and up at me and down at it, and kind of sizing me up, you know? And it occurred to me years later that I probably would have done the same thing if somebody walked up to me out of the blue like that and said, hey man, I wrote a song about you here. Was this crackpot. But suddenly I remembered that there was a photograph in the booklet I kind of fun to show him in person. It was a photo we had created of the word blue in the dirt, you know. Just fit the theme, and I asked for the CD back for a second. I took the shrink wrap off and I handed it to him. Showed him that photo of the word blue in the dirt, and I was hoping I'd get a little reaction, you know. I was not at all prepared for the tear that I saw roll down the side of his cheek. This is my hero.
This was before the days of the million-dollar contracts, and before the days of the artificial grass. He stood up and outside the lines, it's made a fair game for those times. 'Cause Richie Allen, he never kissed a white man's ass. Didn't make any sense.